Today we're going to have a gentle intro to Access 2013, okay? And Colin promises me that this will be in human terms.
Yes.
Okay, Colin, I am sort of a big Excel user.
Mm-hmm.
And there are people that tell me, oh, Dave, you should use Access for that. You should use Access for that. And that's a nice, statment, but I don't know really what to do. I don't know really what my first step mm-hmm. should be. So help me out. How do I get into it?
Well, first off, sometimes your spreadsheets can just get out of hand, right? You find yourself spending too much time scrolling, or you know that there's data in there, but you just can't find it.
Okay.
Another reason to use Access instead of Excel is when you need to track transactions, and by that I usually mean more than just sales. In fact, I always mean more than just sales. Transactions can also mean which student is in which classroom, or it can mean who did I loan that book to. So if we start Access, what you see here is a series of templates, and these first two are blank, meaning you can build anything you want, and then the rest of these are done. They're finished. You can just open them up and use them. Most of these templates are business oriented. You can see that you can track assets or manage tasks or manage projects or issues. And if you don't see what you want, you can always search for something. And so I'm going to search on library.
So this is just like any other Office app where mm-hmm. there are templates available at the start screen, even though this is a database program.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yep. And here's a template that looks promising, so I'll try it. And there's no harm in trying something, okay? And to create a database, you click once, and you give it a name. And if you're not happy with this location down here, you can click and save it someplace else.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're done, you click Create.
All right. And we're making a desktop lending library, is that mm-hmm. what it says?
That's okay. what it is. Now, Access downloads the template and opens it for you, and the next thing you need to do is enable the content. That creates a trusted file. It adds it to your list of trusted files, and it also enables some automation in the database itself to run. You can click buttons and things will happen.
Now, why would it even show me that button? Because I trust Access. It's made by Microsoft.
Yeah, but you don't want to trust you don't want to trust a database unless you know who made it. And in this case, we made it, so they're trustable.
Okay, but some malicious mm-hmm. person could send you some crazy database.
Exactly.
Okay.
Well, yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So this is a lending library, and the wording is a little bit generic. So by asset, they mean book, and so I'll type in, what you have to do is you can just start entering data once you open these things up. There's no need to build anything. And so I'll enter the title of a book. And again, this is, if you're interested in pursuing Access some more, this is probably the one of the best places to start out there.
All right.
And Jeff is here answering questions. I would recommend this book highly.
Jeff's the author of the book.
Yes. The next thing to understand about a lot of these templates is that they have generic placeholder values like these category values here. And so to change those, what I do is I'll simply type a new value, and in this case it's a technical book.
Okay.
And when I press enter, that gives me the chance to edit the list. And so I'll select these and I'll just nuke them.
All right.
And then I'll enter, cookbooks and maybe thrillers.
Okay, so these are types of books.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes. And then you can pick a default value here if you want to, like that.
Okay.
And now that we've added some books, we need to add some people to check the books out too. And so I'll click contact list and I'll add you.
Okay.
Now notice something here. I've typed a value, and I'm going to use the arrow key to move the focus to the next field. You can use the arrow key, the tab key, you can tap or you can click, and as soon as I move that focus, that value is now saved.
Okay.
So you don't have to press Control plus S. So Dave Ludwig, and then when I move the focus again, that value is committed. So I'll add Doug Thomas. There you go, and commit that value.
So if you were doing this for your office and you mm-hmm. had like 20 employees, you'd conceivably enter them all here mm-hmm. so that they can check out the book.
Okay, yes, cool. Yes. And then now that we have now that we have some people to check these, you know, the book out to, I'll add another book.
Interesting title.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that
reminds me of another book out there.
And then we can check things out. So you have this book.
Okay.
Check out. Cool. Doug has that one. And you can see that the status is updated automatically and the name of the person who has it checked out. That's automatic as well.
Oh, okay. So when I was using Excel before, if I said Dave Ludwig checked out Access 2013, mm-hmm. and then it changed to Doug checking that book out, mm-hmm. I would just sort of overwrite that. This mm-hmm. would store,
yes.
the, like you said, the transactions. Mm-hmm. Okay,
yes.
Got it.
Yes. The other thing that you need to understand about these is that when you go to build a database, you're going to build two basic types of databases. One of them is a desktop database, and that's what you just saw me create. Desktop databases run on your computer, and if you want to allow other people to enter data into that database, you distribute that database, but the people who are going to do the data entry have to have a version of Access that is compatible with your database file. Hmm. Now, the other kind of database that you'll build, though, is called a web app, and these are built in Access, but they run on a browser, and they're supported by most of the current common browsers. And you can always tell the difference between a desktop database and a web app, because the web apps have globe icons here.
Okay, like the World Wide Web.
Mm-hmm, yes, and desktop databases have desktop in the template file name.
Okay.
And so creating a web app is pretty similar to creating a desktop database. You select, you enter a name, and we'll call this assets. And then instead of picking a location, what you do is pick a server. Now, this needs to be a SharePoint 2013 server or SkyDrive Pro. Okay, they're the same thing. Once you pick your server, you click Create, and the creation process runs just fine, but it can take a couple minutes. And so to save time, we have a database. This is a web app. We have one open for you. And there are a couple of things that you need to understand. There are a couple of key differences here. First off, data entry happens in the browser. It never happens in the Access client. Second thing you need to understand is that when you want to enter data, you click Edit like this, and we'll just amend. And then when you want to save data, saving isn't automatic. You have to click Save like this.
Okay, so this is, let's orient them a little mm-hmm. bit here. So this is an asset tracking database that's mm-hmm. hosted in the web browser.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
So people don't have to have the Access program on their machines.
That's exactly
they
it.
They can just come here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And
they could be on any kind of computer mm-hmm. that has a recently updated browser.
As long as it's a recent popular browser.
Okay.
Chrome, Firefox, Internet Explorer.
Okay.
Now, I mentioned earlier that you create these things in Access, and then you use them here in the browser, but you also change them in Access, and there are a couple of things I'd like you to understand here. So I'm going to click the settings gear, I guess, mm-hmm. and then click customize in Access,
right.
and then open.
In the program. Okay. It looks a little different, though.
Yes, this is the Access client, and the thing to understand about these is that an Access app is nothing more than HTML5. Okay, mm-hmm. It's HTML and JavaScript. And so the ribbon is a whole lot smaller because Access is only allowing you to create objects in the database, components in the database, that are compatible with HTML5.
Oh, okay.
So
it doesn't let you get into trouble.
No, it doesn't.
Make something that the browser wouldn't understand.
Yes.
Okay.
So I'm going to make a quick change just to show you what the kinds of things that you can do. You can add fields here, you can remove fields, or you can change the look and feel of things. And I'm just going to do a quick change to demonstrate the look and feel. I'll write a line, I'll pick a color, mm-hmm. and as soon as I save, that publishes the changes to the database.
All right.
And so if you come back here and you press F5, otherwise refresh the page, mm-hmm. there you go.
Those okay, changes. Blue and red aligned. Okay, got it.
Yeah.
So I guess the workflow is you create like the database owner or the administrator or the manager, whatever you want to call that, creates the database and access, saves it up to SharePoint, people do data entry up there, and then when you need to customize it, maybe add a new table or add a new field or change the look of it, you do that in access, save, and that those changes are seen by your users?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, the other thing that you need to understand about any access database, it doesn't matter which kind, this applies to apps and it also applies to desktop databases, is that a database is made up of five components or types of components that we just generically refer to as database objects. And those components are tables and queries, forms, reports, and macros.
Okay.
So tables are, well, tables are where your data lives, okay? They're the backbone of your database. And frankly, if you don't have tables, you don't have a database. So, and you can see that in this particular table, these are the two books, and in this table, these are the two people that I entered, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, queries are questions that you ask of your data. For example, who has my books checked out? And assets with transactions here is kind of a techno geek way of saying who has my books checked out. So you can see the two books, and if you scroll over, you can see the two people who have them checked out.
Okay.
Now, forms are data entry forms, is what they mean by this. And forms really do two things. They make data entry a lot easier and a lot more accurate. And you can tell because you can see this form wants you to enter Dave's first name or enter a first name in one field and then a last name in another. And they can also make data entry a lot faster as well, because if you're out there in a table, you have to enter something and then you have to tab over or use the arrow keys or tap, and you have to go across like this. But if all you have is a form, then you can just fly right along.
Okay,
and you only enter what's really necessary as well.
Mm-hmm.
Now, reports are how you present your data visually. Okay, in Excel, you can just grab a chart or a graph and you can drop it anywhere into that big grid of data. With Access, you have to do that in a report. And this is also where you print.
Okay. So now, that's a little bit different of a model if you're used to Excel or actually anything, PowerPoint, Word.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So this is where you go for visually representing your data.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes. Now, macros are a subject all their own. They're how you automate the database. They're how you make something happen when you click a button. And this is an example of a macro, and you can see it looks kind of long and kind of complex, but please don't be intimidated by this, okay?
It looks scary.
Yeah. But it's something that you start with simple macros, like, say, button clicks, and then you move from there.
Do you have to go right into macros when you first learn Access?
No, you don't.
You can use the other four.
Yes, you can create all sorts of databases that don't use macros, and you'll be fine.
Okay. But it's nice to know about. It can help with automating things, I guess.
Yeah.
I think that does it.
Yes.
Yeah. I think that's our general intro to Access. Thanks, Colin, for showing this stuff. And yeah, if you want to learn more about all those different kinds of objects, tables, queries, forms, reports, macros, we've got links to resources here at aka.ms/123access. In fact, many of the links are courses that you've written, video tutorials.
Yes. I've got training courses on everything from database design on up to how to troubleshoot some queries and how to make queries sort of sing for you.
Oh, cool.
Add some power to them.
Okay, good. So check that out for sure if you want to learn more about Access. There's a lot more to learn, and it's, as you can see, pretty powerful. You can see the potential there of what you can build, especially with that Access app. That's pretty neat.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, for general information, aka.ms/offweb for our calendar of topics that are coming up and all sorts of good things like a downloadable Outlook reminder. Okay. And next week, we're going to talk about OneNote for holiday planning. So come back for that. And very special thanks to everyone today in the room. We've got Matt Evans and Jeff and Bruce, Bill, Chris, Colin, of course. Thanks very much for coming, and stick around for that Q&A. Thanks.